make us wear these t-shirts, because love is an action word.
Sometimes I may do seem like I'm doing something that's good, but I gotta remind people, look, all glory belongs to God.
Amen.
Because if it wasn't for God, then I wouldn't be able to do none of the things that I can do.
Amen.
Come Hallelujah. On. And I know somebody in here not really believing that they're healed.
Oh, that's good.
They're not really accepting it all the way.
Hallelujah.
They saying it because you know what? You can make your mouth say anything. So you know what? Don't just let your mouth say it. Believe in your heart that God has already healed you. God has already done that thing. He didn't do it in vain. He didn't die in vain. Everything he did from the beginning, he did. It was a reason why he did it.
Yes, Lord.
God already done it.
Yes, he did.
Let's believe it.
That's it.
Let's not just say what, make our mouth say something. When you say it, mean it, because it's real and it's true.
I'm gonna be reading from Luke 12, verse 40. And it says, therefore you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. This verse right here, when I read it, it had really like pierced my heart, because God said it will come to a point where it's gonna say, well, many gonna say, not a few, many gonna say, Lord, have we prophesied in your name? Lord, have you fed the homeless? Lord, haven't we? And that's something you see everybody doing in church. You see a lot of churches doing it, but it's a heart thing.
That's it, Mike.
You want it?
Like, because we can show that we live for God on the outside, and we can worship in here, lift our hands, mm-hmm. pray, feed the homeless. We can do all that, but if our heart is not really there,
come on, boy.
Yeah.
You better say that.
What is going?
You better say that.
You can worship. If your heart not there, you just making noise. Like, so this verse really had me check my heart and like, God, and I'm living for you, if I'm doing everything that you're calling me to do, what else can I do for you? Like, it really got me on it. I want to take a moment to pray and appreciate God for his grace, for his mercy, for his love. I'm going to read James 1:25. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it, and is not a forgetful hearer but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does. So God says, when you read his word and not just hear it but also do it, he said you will be blessed in whatever you put your hands to do.
Amen. Without further ado, y'all put your hands together for Pastor Katisha Pryor.
Somebody here didn't really fully believe that they was healed. That was me,
partially.
So y'all pray for me, because anytime some feeling different in my body, I'm like, Lord, please don't let this cancer come back. So pray for me. The title of my message is The Teacher. Everybody came up, they gave some scriptures out of Luke. I got some scriptures out of Luke too.
Amen.
All right. Are we not disciples of the Lord? What is a disciple? A personal follower of Jesus during his life, especially one of the 12 apostles. Then it goes on to say, a follower, a student, or a teacher, a leader, or a philosopher. Is that not our God? The Lord God is our teacher and instructor. He has given us his holy word. Just think of the word as a practice guide with the answer key at the end of each section. Or if it's better to think of the Holy Spirit as the teacher's pet, always making straight A's. So he gets to check everyone else's test. We are everyone else. It tells us that God gave us the Holy Spirit as an advocate to help you and be with you forever. John 14:16. But did you receive the Holy Spirit? God gives us a choice. He is a God of freedom of choice. He's not going to force anything on us. Just like the teacher isn't going to force you to study, that's something that you have to do on your own. So if you choose to accept him, it says in John 14:26, but the advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will tell you of everything I have said to you. Didn't I say that the Holy Spirit was the teacher's pet? See, sometimes the teacher pet gets to go to the board and help teach the lesson. The Holy Spirit does that for us. We are the disciples, the students, a personal follower of Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. In Luke 11:1, the disciples asked, Lord, teach us to pray, as John has also taught his disciples. And what did our teacher, our instructor do? He taught them to pray. And the Lord said to them, when you pray, say, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our sins. For we also forgive everyone who has indebted to us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. And then it goes down to Luke 11:9. So I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds. And to him who knocks, it will be opened. If a son asks for bread from any father among you, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent instead of a fish? Or if he asks for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? And if you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Heavenly Father give you the Holy Spirit to those who ask of him? So like I said, we serve a God of choice. So he said, you have to ask. Not, he's going to force it on you. You have to ask. Just like you have to ask your teacher in school for help if you're lacking. Why did God give us such a good gift? The practice book with our lesson plans plus the answer key, the Holy Spirit. The practice book is the Bible for the children. I'm referring to the Bible as the practice book. Because he wants us to succeed and pass every test. He never said that it would be easy, but he has given us everything that we need to do well to prepare us for his coming. Some natural teachers say that they teach their students to ready them for the real world. God, our teacher, teaches us to inform, to equip us for real life, eternal life. So I read a passage and I want to share with you all what it said. The teacher, our God, never ends his lesson, but school is open each morning for a lifetime. This is for the ones who are desperate for what God has to offer. Some students sit in from recess. I was one of them students. I wanted to sit in because I wanted to get all I can get. I want to ace all my tests. So if you desperate for God, then you will sit in. You will sit in from the things that are going on in the world and continue to seek God, to go deeper in God, so that you can be equipped with everything that you need for everyday life. The students may be faithful or irregular in attendance. Which are you today? Do you have perfect attendance or do you have unexcused absence? Wow. It goes on to say, but the teacher is always there and always ready to spend all the time needed to walk and talk us through every point. That's a lifetime of knowledge, a lifetime of joy, and a lifetime of peace, and so much more, if you want. Even our natural teachers are always at school, whether we come or not. And if they can't be present, there's a substitute there. So how many know that the Holy Spirit can act as a substitute? Our spiritual leaders can act as a substitute. Malachi 3:17 says, they shall be mine, says the Lord of hosts, on the day that I make them my jewels, and I will spare them as a man spares his own son who serves him. Then you shall again discern between the righteous and the wicked, between one who serves God and one who does not serve him. How can you do that if you haven't listened to the teacher from the day you were given the lesson to pass the final test? When did your test start? The day you were able to understand right from wrong. The day that you acknowledged God as your Lord and Savior. Therefore, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is a sin. this for our kids, because they think that what they do, they can just do whatever. No, I'm not saying a 2-year-old understands, but I know we have some 8-year-olds in here, 12-year-olds. So you got to understand right from wrong. So it tells us in James 14 and 7 that when you know right from wrong and you still do it, you're responsible for that. Romans 14 and 12. So then each of us shall give account to himself to God. That means you are accountable for yourself. Not your parents, not your brother, not your sister, not your auntie, but you are responsible for your wrongdoing. Proverbs 20:11 says, even a child is known by his deeds, whether what he does is pure and right. So you're not only responsible for when you do wrong, but when you do good as well. You're gonna be rewarded for both of them. But which one is gonna be more pleasurable to you? For your good deeds or your wrong deeds? Acts 1:8 says, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you,
yes,
and you shall be witness to me, yes, in Jerusalem and all of Judah and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. That sounds like a teacher who desires his students to succeed, to ace every test. Because if it wasn't, he wouldn't have given us what we needed. He wouldn't have given us the answer key, the Bible, to instruct us and inform us. So we should study to pass the ultimate test. Listen and accept help from the teacher and the teacher's pet, the Holy Spirit. Have faith that we already aced it, that we are already triumphant, that we are already victorious. Like Pastor Drago said, you gotta have faith bigger than the size of a mustard seed and know that it's already done. And that's all I have for y'all.